come and pray. One of the things that strikes me is as I look at other faiths, you can be a Buddhist all by yourself. You can be a Hindu all by yourself. But the Judeo-Christian faith, the Jewish faith from which we come, and the Christian faith is a faith of community. And we gather together as community. And we gather together as community to support and care for one another and to be cared for. And one of the places where that becomes clearest is this time when we share our joys and our concerns and lift one another up in prayer. And so I'd invite you to share your concerns. I would let you know that Peggy has a doctor's appointment this week. And so Peggy, I know you're watching this on Facebook because you called me on my way in to let me know. And I love, you know what, Joyce, I know I'm talking too much, we're supposed to be praying, I'm sorry. One of the joys of a smaller church is that people check in with one another. This is not a 2,000 member congregation where you've got no idea who the person next to you is. We look in on one another. And that is a wonderful, wonderful thing. And in fact, many of you look in on me. Yvonne, I know you're watching. Yvonne calls me and goes, are you okay? Joyce texts me, are you doing all right? We care for one another. And that becomes more real here as we pray. So I would invite you to share.
A little bit outside our own immediate community, a friend, a brother of the Lord, has an uncle named Don, who's in the hospital with sepsis.
I would like prayer for three personal friends of mine who have just lost their spouses of years. One is Robbie Delina. One is Jim Steadman around the block for me, and got the other one. But I have friends that have lost their mates for life, and they're devastated, so please keep them in prayer.
We are grateful you're back, Stephen. I would pray for our world. I would pray this morning for Cameroon. I would pray for Shin State and for an effort that is being made to get an organization called ICISF, which does trauma work all over the world, to
move into the Chin State area to do work with the internally displaced persons there. I've been able to be active in helping try to connect those folks. You know, when you can't go someplace yourself, then the next best thing is to connect people to each other. And so I would ask you to pray for that effort. Please pray with me. In this silence, I would ask you to remember the face of one of those whose names we have called. And as you remember their face, think of lifting them into the light of God's love and healing. See yourself holding them in the light. And in this spot of silence, speak the deep longings of your own heart. Speak of the places that during this Lenten season you are working on yourself. Oh God, we lift these prayers. We lift these people. We lift those in this sanctuary one by one. And we pray that you will touch us and hold us and keep us this day. For your name's sake, we ask in the name of the one who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place.
Children, and all of those who are watching who are children at heart, because this is your time. I want to tell you a little story. When my children were small, it's hard to imagine them being small now because two of the three have children of their own now. But when my children were small, I used to sit and hug them very tight. And I would sing them a little song. I have a talking teddy bear. I take it with me everywhere. And then I'd let my arms loose and I'd say, and when it tries to run away, and they'd giggle and run off, and I'd grab them and pull them back and go, I hold them very close and say, no, no, you can't go. See, daddies can do that no matter if they can't sing or not. But the neat thing was it became this wonderful game between us. And I've done it with my grandchildren, one of whom is in college now. And if she's watching, she's probably very embarrassed. Good. Embarrassing your grandchildren is fun. It's a way that grandparents get joy in life. But I started thinking this morning about how that is with us and God.
God holds us really close. And when we squirm and wiggle and get away, God pulls us back. Because we are God's, and God loves us, and God never stops trying to hug the world back to itself. So I want you to think about that song, as silly as it may sound, but I want you to think sometimes about that when maybe you do something or something happens that makes you think that you're way apart from God, God is hugging you back to God's self, because we belong to God, and God will never let us go. Thank you. Please stand up. Please look around on this first morning of daylight savings time and wave to somebody. Wave up to the Facebook people and the Zoom people and say, "The peace of God be with you." And the peace of God be with each of you. Let me try that again. Y'all are still hugging up on each other. Y'all are acting like Baptists. We are getting back to it. The peace of God be with you. I'm going to ask that Joyce come now and lead us in the prayer to bless our all.
Father God, we thank you for the offerings that we have to give back to you today. We thank you for providing them to us, and we use them now to further your kingdom in your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Praise Him above all.
now and then I get one of these weird thoughts. I know some of you who know me better are looking at me right smart and going, what do you mean every now and then? You have weird thoughts all the time. But every now and then I get one of these weird thoughts when I've already got my sermon ready that I need to say something a little different or add something a little different. And so I want to tell you that thought as we move into our sermon. Here was the thought. As we're going through Lent, or even through life, and I don't need a show of hands, I want to let you keep this a little private. Have you had something that seems to always get in your way? It seems like as you look at it during Lent, it's that thing that sort of blocks our way. In our relationship to God. Have you got something like that? The things that you feel like you ought to be doing, but something seems to always. So here's my thought. If you were not meant, and I'll even add to us as a church, as in our life together, particularly some of you who have been here for a long time, you ever feel like we're supposed to be doing something? Not quite sure what it is, but something. If any of that resonates with you, if any of that feels true, then this is what I want to say to you. You must be meant to do something great if the devil is spending so much energy to stop you. Think about it. You know, if you've got a linebacker who always sacks the quarterback, they'll spend half the line stopping from coming in. But if there's some little dinky guy out there that's never worried about, you don't bother to block him. You block the one who's a threat. Think about what's blocking you. Evil is spending a lot of energy to stop you from being what you can be. And with that said, I'll just leave that with you and let's move into our sermon. Every one of us who is a parent has heard this phrase. It's my life. Why do you keep trying to ruin my life? Your life is over.
Oh, really?
This is my life. Bear that in mind as we read this scripture. And if you don't see where I'm going, that's okay. Hang on. Our first scripture is from 1 Chronicles 21, 1 through 8. Satan stood up against Israel and incited David to count the people of Israel. He's going to do a census. So David said to Joab and the commanders of the army, go number Israel from Beersheba to Dan and bring me a report so that I may know their number. But Joab said, may the Lord increase the number of his people 100-fold. Are they not, my lord the king, all of them my lord's servants? Why should my lord require this?
Why should he bring guilt on Israel? But the king's word prevailed against Joab, and so Joab departed and went throughout all of Israel and came back to Jerusalem. And Joab gave the total count of the people to David. In all Israel, there were 1,100,000 men who drew the sword, who were old enough to fight. And in Judah, 470,000 who drew the sword, but he did not include Levi and Benjamin in the numbering, for the king's command was abhorrent to Joab. Help me with this, please. Who does Israel belong to? Let me ask you again, say it louder. Who does Israel belong to? And in David's time, you didn't count anything that didn't belong to you. Now, when you hear that, this story takes on a much deeper meaning. David is acting like Israel is his. No wonder Joab said, "What are you doing? What are you doing? May God increase God's people, but why, these people will come to you anytime you ask them to. Why are you trying to count them like they were your belonging?" By the way, whenever you do a census, of course, the next thing you're going to do is taxes. I mean, think about it. Even in Jesus' day, Caesar sent out a decree to count the whole world so that it could be taxed. We do a census here in part so we can be taxed. But in Israel, in David's day, you were not supposed to count anything that did not belong to you. That's one of the reasons why the psalmist says to us, God made us and we are his. We are the sheep of his pasture. We belong to God. And remembering that, this is allergy season for me. We belong to God. Israel makes that clear. I do not belong to myself. So let's go for a moment into Luke 15. And take a look at this ongoing story. I'm going to only read two, three verses of the prodigal son. Verses 13 through 16. A few days later, the younger son gathered all he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in desolate living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine took place throughout that country. And he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country who sent him to his field to feed the pigs, and he would gladly have filled himself with the pods the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. This is the story of a man who had decided decided that his life belonged to him. Do you remember what he said to his father? Father, give me mine. Now you have to remember that in that day, the day of Jesus' parable, in an agricultural area, that land might be his upon the death of his father, which is really kind of interesting because when you say that to your father in that day, what you're saying is, you know, you're not dying fast enough, so give me my inheritance now. I wish you were dead so I could have it, but since I can't, since you're not, you know, get, so it was all in land. And the people of the village and the surrounding area farmed that land for the landowner and received a portion of the produce of that land. And so if you sell that land off, the people around you suffer. But this young man said, this is mine. It belongs to me. I can do whatever I want to with it. And he sold off pieces of that land, and he took his money, and he hit the road. And he went to a far country, and the way you get to know people when you're in a place like that is you throw parties. You throw meals. You invite lots of people so that you can make friends. And one day you expect to be invited to their place. But there was a famine. And suddenly, the people he invited to the party weren't throwing parties of their own because nobody had anything. And he did what was common. He attached himself to someone who still had money or land. The guy didn't come up to him and say, Joe, come work for me. No. He followed the landowner around everywhere he went. You got any work? You got any work today? Can I carry your bag? Maybe you'll give me a tip. Let me wash the window on your car. I'll go away and leave you alone if you give me $1. He attached himself to this man of wealth. And finally, I'm moving this way now. Stan's really good at following me with that camera. I appreciate it. Because I've started moving around again. And I love it. So he attached himself to this man. And finally, the man in frustration sent him to feed his pigs. Now that's insulting. I mean, think about it. This is a Jew. Pork is outlawed for him. So I'm going to try to give you the job that you will hate the most, and maybe you'll go away. This was not an act of kindness. It was a get away from me, you bother me. And he was so desperate that he went. And he would gladly have eaten slop. This is what happens when we decide that our life is our own. It's more important for me to have a thing that I want than to imagine and realize that my life does not belong. When I decide that my life is my own, I cannot in things going well. Now, perhaps it may be that I don't wind up feeding pigs somewhere or washing windshields at the stoplight. And please don't go thinking to yourself that somebody is begging on the street. Well, obviously, that guy thought his life belonged to him. I don't mean this as a model for you to judge others. I mean it as a model for you and I to look at us. Because during this Lenten season, I got to tell you, I have started looking at myself and all the places that I have claimed my life is my own. Now, before you go, wow, I'd never do that. What's the matter with that preacher? Ask yourself, how many times have you said, in one way or another, God, I will do anything you want, except I want to still hold on to this. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
I was the only one. I'll do anything, except let me have this little piece of selfishness or greed or lust, or whatever it might be that I want to use over in this little corner. Florence is a wonderful gardener, and I'm really impressed with what she does, and so I'm going to ask her this question. When you garden, do you clear everything out before you plant? Or do you put a patch over there where you let the weeds stay so that they'll have a place in their own? You clear everything out. But you and I, we keep going, well, I want a little patch for my weeds. I want to have a flourishing, beautiful life for God, but I want my life's garden to have a little patch for my weeds. Because I think my life belongs to me, and I can do that. My life does not belong to me. Your life does not belong to you. You and I belong to God. Now, if I stop there, it's only bad news, because all of us are sitting here kind of squirming a little bit, because we've all got a patch of weeds somewhere. That'd be my guess. I know I do. I still want to have my little patch of weeds. I like my weeds. They calm me down when I'm upset. And when the other part of my garden isn't blooming the way I want it to or think it should right now, my weeds make me happy. And I go sit in my weeds and I go, it's okay. The tomatoes aren't blooming yet, and I really want tomatoes, but I'll settle for a little bit of weed stew. My life does not belong to me. But as long as evil can tell you it does, and you can call that evil the devil, you can call it Satan, you can call it the universal urge to kill off everything good. Call it what you want to. But I tell you, that's what whispers in your ear to say, you really deserve to have a little plot of weeds. I mean, it's your life. Look at all you're doing for God. You need a reward. Ever done that? Ever rewarded yourself with some of your weed stew because you've been so good all day? I worked hard all day for you, God, and so I'm going to go over here and have a little weed stew. And I think God sighs. Because God knows what we keep forgetting, even though it happens to us over and over again. When I start counting my life as though it belongs to me, like David with his army, or the prodigal son with the property, there is no place to go but down. There is a poem that became a song for Simon Garfunkel. And some of you may remember these words. They say that Richard Corey owns one half of this whole town, with political connections to spread his wealth around. Born into society, a banker's only child. He had everything a man can want, power, wealth, and style. But I work in his factory, and I curse the life I'm living, and I curse my poverty, and I wish that I could be, Richard Corey. So my mind is filled with wonder when the evening headlines read that Richard Corey went home last night and put a bullet through his head. When we begin to count as ours what belongs to God, there is nothing at the end of that road but hunger and a willingness to eat the slop that the pigs are fed. Does that sound harsh? Perhaps. But one of the things that I have found as a pastor and as a therapist and someone working in mobile crisis situations is it does no good to sugarcoat the truth. People who are sick know this. They say, Doc, will you quit beating around the bush and tell me the truth? Oh, well, you might be a little sick. And we may have to spend some time in the hospital on oxygen and tanks and, you know, not telling the truth. And here is the truth. You and I belong to God. And so often we forget that. And as we follow this young man down the road to the far country, we need to remember that his story is our story. But that's all bad news. Want to know what the good news is? Remember my song with the children, with my grandchildren, with my children. I have a talking teddy bear, and I take it with me everywhere. When it tries to run away, I hold it very close and say, no, you can't get away. Hear God sing that song to you. You are mine, and I love you. And when you try to run away, I will reach for you to hug you back to myself. That's the good news. God never gives up on his beloved. And you are God's beloved. That father, even while his son is down eating stolen slop, is standing on the porch looking down the road for his son to come home. The way home runs through Lent. It runs through taking up our cross, which may be our weed patch. It may simply be that our cross is
you know, I have some stuff in my life I gotta work on. But the way of the cross leads home. Home where the Father stands on the porch looking down the road, because like my song with the talking teddy bear, every time I try to run away, God wraps God's arms around me and says, no. Because who do we belong to?
God.
Who do we belong to?
God.
Thank you. Let's try it again. Who do we belong to?
God.
And God will not let us go. So the truth is, when that teenager or the teenager in us is stomping its feet going, it's my life, the answer is, no, it's not. It's alone. It's a loner. And sooner or later, we will give it back. And that's not a bad thing, because we worship a God who in love is going to give us new life. We worship a God who not only looks down the road waiting for us to come home, but we worship a God who raises the dead. For nothing can separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So during this Lenten season, as you look and you find those places where you have counted what does not belong to you, when you have claimed what does not belong to you, but belongs to God, know that God stands at the end of the road waiting for you to come home, because you and I belong to God. Amen. Please stand with me as we sing our last song.
We stand and lift up our hands for the joy of the Lord. Bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God. Yeah.
especially those who are with us this morning on Facebook, to consider as we look at that turning to come back up the road, which, by the way, is what our young man starts to do next week as we follow his story. Perhaps as a symbol for that in your life, you might choose to join us on Easter morning. You see, the way home leads through Lent. And we do not worship alone. We are a community. And COVID has made some of us perhaps forget how much we need that community. So give it some thought. It would be wonderful if on Easter morning we all started coming home and looking at what it means for this congregation to be the listening church and to see what it does with the life that belongs not to us, but to God. And go from this place strengthened by the knowledge that in the goodness of God you were born. By the watchfulness of God you are kept all the day long, and in the mercy and love of God. God is hugging us all back to God's self, where we can be redeemed and made whole. Amen. Have a great week. We will see you on Tuesday for devotion.